I heard that yesterday you worked through the exercises and through the lecture, or at least some of you. Are there some questions that I should answer? Or maybe more details? No, everything seems to be clear. So if there are any questions also in the future, feel free to come to me. We can discuss. I'd be happy to do that. Okay, so what were we discussing yesterday was how to construct a stochastic Itô integral. So we wanted to understand how to make sense. So this is now evaluation at time s, and we wanted to understand how to make sense of such an object. Yeah, we have seen W for us at first was a one-dimensional Brownian motion, and we have seen that the trajectories of the Brownian motion are very irregular. They are so irregular that in cases when that we are interested in, we cannot make sense of this integral as a classical Lebesgue-Siltius integral. And therefore we said, well, maybe probability theory can give us a helping hand. And indeed it does. Yeah, so we have also understood that for our applications that we want to study later, namely where here we would have some process that maybe depends on a solution to some stochastic partial differential equation, we also cannot expect this process here to be very regular in time. Yeah, so this was another argument why really analysis is not enough for us. And so the hope was that probability can help us. And indeed, we have understood that we need some additional assumptions on this process here. So phi, let's say it is a stochastic process, meaning for every s, this is a mapping from omega to R in the simple setting. It is measurable mapping. And we have postulated in addition the so-called progressive measurability. Now that was a strange definition, but somehow we said, okay, probability theory, sorry? Change the pen. You cannot see it very well, right? Let's see if this is better. Should be better. Okay, thank you. So we said that there is a price to pay. And the price to pay is we have to keep track of this arrow of time. And this is what we encoded in this measure theoretic definition of progressive measurability. Yeah, with respect to some filtration, so some family of sigma algebras, and it is an increasing family or non-decreasing family of sigma algebras. So this was one assumption that we needed to consider on our stochastic process phi. And the second assumption was a certain integrability, L2 integrability condition. Yeah, so we require the following. We require that this integral, this expectation, is finite. Then you remember, then the way we constructed the Itô stochastic integral was to start with piecewise constant processes. We call them elementary processes. And any process in this class can be approximated by exactly those processes, right? And for these elementary processes, it was easy to construct what should be called an integral because they're really piecewise constant. So in that sense, the construction is very similar to that of the Lebesgue integral. Okay, and so under these conditions, we get really good properties of the stochastic integral. In particular, there was the Itô isometry, which is really the somehow the one of the stochastic analysis magics. So what does it say? If I take expectation of the square of the stochastic integral, actually, I get an equality, and it is equal to the expectation of the integral from 0 to capital T. And here, I put the square inside. Yeah, so this is, again, something. This is what is very special for the stochastic integral, for the stochastic integral that we construct here, in particular, due to the fact that it is a martingale. Yeah, so for that, we used this progressive measurability assumption, and this is the key point which allows us to prove this Itô isometry. So this is, I didn't discuss the proof yesterday, but this is really the essential point of that. And you also see that we require for the definition of the stochastic integral the right-hand side to be finite. Okay, so this was in the one-dimensional situation, namely when the process is real-valued and also the Brownian motion itself is real-valued. Yeah, and then we wanted to think about a possible extension to several dimensions. So we wanted to consider an m-dimensional Brownian motion. And I said the definition of this object is very straightforward. It just means that this vector consists of one-dimensional Brownian motions and they are mutually independent. So okay, this can be built from what we learned yesterday. And then what is a reasonable class of processes that we can integrate? Yeah, we said, okay, now they should be matrix valued. So I would like to have phi s mapping from omega to r, let's say n times n. Yeah, in other words, I could say that the process takes values in the bounded linear operators from r m to Rn, because this is exactly what matrices are. Yeah, but we should not forget all our other assumptions. So I still need progressive measurability, and I still need exactly this integrability condition, where this was just absolute value, but now for me this would be the Euclidean norm on the space Rn times n. Yeah? Okay, and so under these two conditions, again, I could make sense of the stochastic integral, and the question is where does it actually take values, right? Because in the first setting here, if everything is real valued, also the stochastic integral takes values in R almost surely, or for every omega, and here we should really keep in mind somehow this picture of matrix vector multiplication. So what I get in the end is a vector, and I could also write it this way. So I should do the matrix vector multiplication. Okay, now to get it right. So this is really, you recognize the matrix vector multiplication here, and we get a vector in the end. Okay, so the construction of this stochastic integral follows really exactly the same argument. Yeah? So there is no big difficulty. And now I want to consider even a further extension, namely, what if the Brownian motion was infinite dimensional? Yeah. Because if you think about it, well, our stochastic process phi that we want to actually apply this theory to, it would somehow appear in the Navier Stokes system, and it is a PDE, so it can be regarded as an ODE in infinite dimensions, right? So this guy will already take values in some Hilbert space maybe, or Banach space or whatever. Yeah, what I want to say, it will take values in some infinite dimensional space. And then for modeling purposes, well, there is no reason why the Brownian motion should be only finite dimensional in that case. Yeah, so what I would like to consider now is the infinite dimensional setting. So the question is, not only the Brownian motion, but also the process phi takes values in some infinite dimensional space. So in particular, I will take two separable Hilbert spaces, U and H. U will be for the Brownian motion, so I want that my Brownian motion in some sense takes values here. H will be for the process phi. Okay, so in this situation, how can I formulate even an infinite dimensional Brownian motion? So here we call it a cylindrical Wiener process. So W is a cylindrical Wiener process. Wiener process on U. What does this mean? What does this mean? So I take an orthonormal basis EI. This is a complete orthonormal system in my separable Hilbert space U. Okay. And then I define my cylindrical Wiener process basically by assigning values for elements of this basis. Namely, so W at time t would be given by this formal sum I equal 1 to infinity W I t E I. So here I see the elements of the orthonormal basis, and W I, these are real valued Brownian motions. They are again mutually independent. Yes. So I have this formal expansion, and we will see in a minute why I say formal. Yeah, because okay, so you prescribe the values for each element of the basis. Maybe to compare also to the previous setting in Rm, this could also be regarded exactly in the same way. Right, because okay, here I identified the Brownian motion with these coefficients, with these WIs, but exactly as over there, I could write here W is the sum I equal 1 to M. Here the space is only M dimensional, and I have WI, these are real valued, and then I have elements of the orthonormal basis of Rm. Yeah, so this is really very analogous, except for that here the sum is finite, and you know you don't have to worry about convergence of anything here. But now a new question pops up, namely in which sense can this sum converge? Because suddenly the sum is infinite. We have to make sure that we get some convergence. Okay, and so let us think about the convergence for the moment. Yeah, the question is, can we prove that it converges maybe in some good probabilistic sense? Yeah, maybe we would really like to have this process W to take values in U. So maybe I would like to take the norm in U and prove that it is finite. Yeah, so let us think about it now for a moment. What happens? I will also take expectation. What happens if I really now blindly do this? So I take the norm in U to the power 2 and expectation. And somehow, yeah, it would make sense if the whole thing was finite, right? So what do you think? Maybe you think about it for a while. How can we compute? How can we estimate this? Okay, so I can plug in my sum. Okay, so that's a norm in a Hilbert space. Anyone has an idea? Yes?
Dependency of the WI, and write that sum is equal to summation I go to infinity into T, because the expectation of WI square is T.
Yes. Yes, exactly, that is correct. Yeah, so one way also maybe slightly different to get to that is, have you heard about Parseval inequality?
Yes.
So this is what I can use here. What it gives me, so I keep my expectation, then I have the sum over I, and I have square of, and now the inner product of WT with the elements of the orthonormal basis. This is now inner product in U, and it goes to the power 2. So this is just the Parseval equality. And now the point is that I know what this is, right? Because I have my formula over there, and we know that these EIs, they are elements of an orthonormal basis. So this is really equal to WI at time t. Yeah, and so we get really to where you wanted us to get. I get expectation, I keep my sum, and here I have WI t to the power 2. And now it's good because, okay, I can exchange, I can put the expectation here, and we know what is the law of this random variable. Yeah, we know that WI is a Brownian motion, real valued. So this is what we saw yesterday. There was a definition. So what is the law of this random variable? Maybe somebody remembers? You said it already, so. So it is the normal distribution, expectation 0, and variance t. And so what we see, if I put the expectation here inside, this is precisely the variance. Yeah, and this is t, by definition of our process. So what I end up with is a sum, and now I remind you that the sum is infinite of t's. Yeah, and now you see that does not look very converging. So this is indeed infinity. And what this suggests is that our cylindrical Wiener process actually does not take values in our space U at all. No. So that's a good point, and that's an important point to remember. But still we want to keep the definition this way, so I like the definition. But the question is, what can we do about it? We are in some space where we do not converge. So somehow the idea could be, well, we make the space bigger and hope to converge there. This is precisely what helps us here. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, so this is one idea, but maybe I'll start with another idea. So the first idea is actually, okay, this thing does not converge, but maybe we don't care very much because, well, we want to construct an integral. Somehow this Brownian motion is kind of multiplied by the process phi. And in a sense, this process can make things converging, so it can help us. Yeah, so this is one requirement. It would basically mean we strengthen our assumptions on this coefficient here. Because if you think about it, kind of, it's like here I would get an infinite sum. Also maybe that's not such a good analogy. But the idea is really to strengthen the assumptions on this coefficient here so that everything converges. So basically I want to say that phi WT would be converging by a suitable assumption on phi. Yeah, and now the question is, of course, what is a suitable assumption? And it turns out that what we had here, bounded linear operators from Rm to Rn. So if I postulated that, again, phi take, okay, let's say at time s, takes values in bounded linear operators from now from u to h. Actually, it turns out this would not be enough, yeah, because this would not make the sum converging. So what we postulate instead is I put a little 2 here, and I call this space Hilbert-Schmidt. And I postulate that my process takes values in the space of Hilbert-Schmidt operators from u to h. I should tell you what these operators are. So on Rm, in finite dimensional setting, they coincide with bounded linear operators. The difference is only seen on infinite dimensional spaces because the corresponding norm looks like this. So if I compute the norm of phi s in this Hilbert-Schmidt space, let's say to the power 2, it is again a Hilbert space. It is given by the sum I equal 1 to infinity. And now I apply my operator phi at time s to each element of the orthonormal basis of u. And so I apply to ei, and now this will be an element of h, and I take it to the power 2. So what I should say is that the Hilbert-Schmidt operators from u to h, they're a subset of bounded linear operators. That's why whenever I take an element of u and I apply my operator phi to it, I get an element of h. Yeah, and this is what defines the Hilbert-Schmidt norm, and it should be, of course, finite. Okay, and so the only difference now in a construction of such a stochastic integral is that whenever I wrote here absolute value, or in this higher dimensional setting, it meant the Euclidean norm on the space of matrices, I should put there the Hilbert-Schmidt norm. So then for the stochastic integral, I postulate that phi is again progressively measurable, so that's really the same. I cannot forget that. And my condition is now given by integral from 0 to capital T, and here I should take the Hilbert-Schmidt norm from u to h to the power 2 ds, and this should be finite. Yeah, and so you see it here somehow. In a sense, this operator phi now takes care of the infinite sum, and it makes everything converging. Yeah, so under this setting, I recover really consistent and analogous theory to what we have seen here. So I can again define a stochastic integral I can construct it by using again the elementary processes really in the same way. Now the question is, where does it take values? So the stochastic integral, it must be h valued. Because it's again the analogy with the matrix vector multiplication. So this is u valued, these are operators from u to h, therefore the whole integral is h valued. And exactly as before, we have the Itô isometry. So now I just have to be careful to formulate it in the correct way. I said the stochastic integral is h valued. Therefore, I should take the h norm, let's say integral from 0 to t, phi dw in the h norm to the power 2. And now this must be equal to the integral from 0 to little t, and here we will see the Hilbert-Schmidt norm again. Yes. And we know that this is finite by assumption over there. Yeah, so really the Hilbert-Schmidt assumption is the key point that somehow avoids this problem with some infinite sum, because the operator phi makes the sum converging. And so this is one possibility, and this is what we will indeed consider for the Navier Stokes system. Yeah, so basically we would say, okay, the Brownian motion or the cylindrical Wiener process is maybe not converging, but I will take sufficient assumptions on my coefficient here so that the integral makes sense really in this space H. And there is actually another idea what one can do. I have already mentioned that very briefly. Somehow, how to fix this convergence issue, right? So I said, well, the sum does not converge in U, but maybe I can enlarge my space and then to make the sum converging. So this is what I can discuss now. So I consider an auxiliary space. I call it U naught, and it is a so U is a subspace of that, and I can define it as follows. So U naught contains all the elements V that are given by the sum, so infinite sum, I equal 1 to infinity. Let's say here the coefficient is called alpha I, and the orthonormal basis element EI, so that the sum I equal 1 to infinity alpha I over I to the power 2 is finite. Okay, so what does that mean now? So here I again prescribe the values for every element of the orthonormal basis. So somehow I take my orthonormal basis in U, I put there a value. So alpha I is a real number. And it's similar to the Brownian motion over there. Yeah, but then the condition... Oh. I think there must be square, otherwise. Yeah, I think that should be there. Yeah, but the difference is, so it's not really the space U, as you can see, because I added this little I square to the denominator. Yeah. And the reason for that is, well, even sequences alpha I, so that that didn't converge without I square, they are now in this space, so there is really more sequences. So that's how you can check that it's really U is a subspace of that. So somehow it's like I put there a weight to make more sums converging. Okay, and so now the question is whether my Brownian motion, so the cylindrical Wiener process, whether it maybe takes values here in this space U naught. In other words, can I now prove that this sum actually converges in U naught? And you see that there is hope, because I have edited these weights, so more sums should be converging now. Okay, so how can we check that? Well, we would like to follow this computation, right? But now in the space U naught. Okay, so what have we done? We can start it here. So I would like to take expectation of W at time t in U naught to the power 2. Okay, and so the first step is, as before, is a Parseval. So I get expectation of the sum, and what is here now is, I call it f I, So now I have to take a different orthonormal basis, right? Fi should be an orthonormal basis of U naught, and the inner product is also in U naught. Yeah, so I will now erase the blackboard, and you can think in the meantime, how can we compute this and whether it actually helps? So whether it is enough to show that this expression is finite. Sorry? Yeah, so what is Fi? Here, Fi are elements of an orthonormal basis in U naught. Yeah, so, I mean, at the moment, they're somehow abstract. There is some basis. But maybe what you should think about is how to choose a good basis, because that will help us. Also this already. Yes. So, any suggestions? Okay, so let us think about it together. Well, I said here, for the moment, there is some orthonormal basis. Yeah, maybe we should choose a good one. So what would be a good orthonormal basis? Yeah, exactly. I would like to somehow look at these. Maybe, but the first question is, are these an orthonormal basis of this new space? Yeah, so we know that EI, they are in an orthonormal basis of the previous space, this one. Yeah, now we added these weights, so probably they cannot be orthonormal anymore. But somehow, that just means I need to cancel this weight. So what if I defined Fi to be IEI? Would this help? It would indeed, right? Because if I now compute Fi in U naught, let's say the norm U naught square, that means IEI. U naught square, that's correct. And I look, I mean, the norm should be given by this, right? So I take the coefficients to the power 2 and divide by I square. And the coefficient here is I. Okay, so that just means I get I square here, and I should divide by I square. So it is 1. Yeah. So somehow this I is just a natural number. Yeah, so the norm of these guys is 1, and they are also orthogonal. This is what you can check very easily. They are orthogonal because it's just the original ones multiplied by a number, and the original ones were orthogonal. Yeah. Uh-huh. you know. Okay. So that means we already have a good basis that we want to use. Now the question is, what is this inner product here? Yeah, so how is inner product in this space defined? Well, I take the coefficient of one of them times the coefficient of the other one, and I divide by I square. Yeah, so that means that here what I get is wi at time t, because that was the coefficient of w, and here I divide by I. Yeah, basically there is another I divided by I, but they cancel out. So what I get there is wi t over I. Yeah, is this clear to everybody? One just has to plug in into this inner product. Okay, and so I can continue my computation, and what I get is therefore the sum over I 1 over I square, because there was a square. And again, expectation of wi at time t to the power 2. Yeah, and you see that now is the situation much better, because exactly as before, this is equal to t, but now the sum is converging. Yeah, so this is now finite. So let's say this is equal to some constant times t. Yeah, so this is finite now. In other words, what we could prove is that the cylindrical Wiener process takes values in this bigger space U0. And actually, this is the space that one should work with. So actually, one could also prove that the trajectories of W are continuous, even Helder continuous in U0. So that means that W takes values in the space of continuous functions with values in U0, almost surely. Okay, so this is the second way how one can fix this problem. And actually, we will need both. Because eventually, for our SPDE, we will need some kind of continuity property of the Brownian motion. And so for that, we will then remember that we had this space capital U0 where the trajectories were continuous. Yeah, and on the other hand, we also have to make sure that our integrand takes values in the space of Hilbert-Schmidt operators. So now I would like to be more precise about the particular setting that I will then use for the stochastic Navier Stokes system. So later, for the stochastic Navier Stokes equations, what I would like to consider is the following setup. So for me, the space H will be just L2. Yes. I think we will probably work on the torus, so that would mean, yeah, this by this I mean the d-dimensional torus. So that means let's say this way, I am on the box 0, 1, 1. With periodic boundary conditions. Yeah, so basically, I glue this point to that one, I glue that point to that one. But you can also think really just being on such a box and having periodic boundary conditions. Yeah, so the function is periodic. So this is what I denote by d-dimensional torus. Sorry, I didn't understand the question. Are you asking about this space here? It's one possibility. I don't say it's the only one. Yes, yes. Yeah, it's just one has to choose something. Say it again, please. Yeah, exactly. I agree with you. I could have chosen like many different weights here, which would give me different spaces. So this is really just one of them. I think the only information that I then need is maybe some good properties of the trajectories. But for that, I really just need... I think the only thing that I need is that the embedding, so the identity from U to U naught, is Hilbert-Schmidt. Yeah, we remember what was the Hilbert-Schmidt norm, and here I want the identity to be Hilbert-Schmidt. And yeah, as an exercise, if you wish, you can check that indeed here for this setting it is true. But I mean, any space where the embedding is Hilbert-Schmidt would do. Yes. It's somehow, yeah, then it's analogy to why I needed Hilbert-Schmidt operators here. So I would also need them here for the identity, basically. That is the same idea, but it's a very good point. Thank you. Maybe some other questions? Okay, so let us go back to the stochastic Navier Stokes. So I would like to have a stochastic Navier Stokes and to include, let's say, integer from 0 to t of some coefficient phi which depends on my solution dw. So this is what I would like to have in my PDE, where w will be the cylindrical Wiener process. So we have already understood that now the integrand has to take values in the space of Hilbert-Schmidt operator. So this is what we see here. Progressively measurable and takes values in the Hilbert-Schmidt operators. Yeah, and I will take even a more particular setting. To be honest, the generality that we have there would be sufficient and wouldn't hurt us anywhere. So that would be possible. But maybe for simplicity, I would like to take further assumptions. So if U belongs to L2 over the torus, I define the value of this operator phi of U. So this should be now an operator from U to H. So operator from U to H, which is now L2. And how do I define this operator? Again, I prescribe the values on my orthonormal basis. And so it is sufficient to say how does it act on every element of the orthonormal basis here. And this is precisely what I do. So phi of u applied to ek. Ek is my basis from before. This will be given by some function gk. So basically, I want to consider Nemitzky operators. Yeah, here the function gk, I will need certain assumptions. For the moment, it should be continuous on the torus times, and if our solution is rd valued, then times rd. Yeah, so a continuous function. And now you see this whole thing, this whole composition, shall be in L2. Yeah, so the x dependence is here. this is what you see there. And dx dependence is also in my function u. So it is really a composition of two functions. In other words, it is an Nemetsky operator. We will set it up in a way so that it's a particular example of that setting. But actually, as I said, more general examples are also possible. Okay, so I would like my operator to look like this. And now the question is, does it really take values in the space of Hilbert-Schmidt operators? Because this is still what I need to check. Or I have to postulate further assumptions to make that happen. And so what I postulate is the so-called linear growth assumption. And so the coefficients gk, they should be of linear growth, but I should not forget my sum. So there is still the infinite sum, and I have to take care of that. So what I assume is the following. Okay, this should be xi. Actually, it's a linear growth of the whole sum. So there will be some constant, which depends only on my coefficients, 1 plus, and here, xi to the power 2. Yeah, and this should now hold for every x in the torus and every xi in R. Okay, so this is what I need to postulate, and now I claim that this is enough to ensure the Hilbert-Schmidt condition. Okay, in other words, what I say is that the operator phi of u, now defined this way, is a Hilbert-Schmidt operator. And this is what we should verify. You see, somehow in principle, like, there is hope because there is some sum of some squares and it is converging. So, okay, there is hope. And it's indeed how I set things up. So it's a little lemma. So phi, if I plug in really a function in L2, this goes into the space of Hilbert-Schmidt operators of u from u to L2 over the torus. And so maybe we can discuss the proof a little bit, but maybe you can then think about it also later. So why should it be true? Maybe at least we can start the beginning, and I leave the rest then to you. Okay, so what I should prove is that the Hilbert-Schmidt norm is finite. So I plug in u in L2, and now I compute the Hilbert-Schmidt norm to the power 2. And so now we should look or remember what the definition of the Hilbert-Schmidt norm was. So I said these are a subset of bounded linear operators from u to h, okay, and the norm was the following. So k equal 1 to infinity, and phi of u shall be applied to an element of the orthonormal basis of u, and now this is in h to the power 2. Yeah, now you probably see already where this is going. Because these are precisely the values of phi of u that I defined here. Yeah. So I think I'll leave the rest for you to do later. But basically what you just need to do is you plug in the definition of my operator. And then you know that h is just the L2 norm, because this is what my space h now is. And you should use this assumption. Yeah, and then again, in the end, you will need to use the fact that u belongs to L2 as well. Yeah, so I leave this to you. So this is a homework for today. And so what the lemma tells us is that if we define our operator now this way through these functions gk, and if we have the linear growth assumption in this form for the functions gk, then the operator indeed takes values in the space of Hilbert-Schmidt operators. Yeah? So now this is a good operator to be put inside the stochastic integral. Yeah, of course, I have to worry about the progressive measurability still, but you should also observe that eventually I want to apply it to U, which is really a solution to the stochastic partial differential equation. So the randomness comes to this phi of U only through the solution U. Yeah? Otherwise, the function phi does not depend on any additional randomness, or there is also no additional time dependence. So time and randomness only come through the function U, or can only come through the function U. Yeah, so actually when we then later will worry about progressive measurability of such a composition, we actually worry about progressive measurability of this U that we will plug in. Yeah, so for the moment we don't have to worry about it. What I just want to say is we can also rewrite this integral in the following way. So the stochastic integral can be written as follows. And I use it with U. Let's say U is maybe a solution to the Navier Stokes, so there is no problem with the progressive measurability. Yeah, and what I can do now is I use my formula for W. Yeah, there was this infinite series, and I can just plug it in now. And what I get is the sum over k, now the integral from 0 to t, phi of u ek dwk. Yeah, so this is what happens when I use my formal expansion of the Brownian motion. I plug it in. I see the elements of the orthonormal basis here, and now for every k, if I forget the sum, this is in fact a just real valued, standard, the first Itô integral that we considered here. Yeah, so we are really, if I forget the sum, we are now back to the setting of yesterday, and there is somehow no problem. Yeah, so I can also use my definition of this operator, of the operator phi of u. So I keep the sum, I have the integral from 0 to t, and now I plug in my functions gk's. Let me write it this way, dwk. Yeah. Okay. Now we should remember there was this x dependence hidden here, but actually really for every fixed x, what I have here is just an Itô integral of a one-dimensional function with respect to a one-dimensional Brownian motion. Yeah, so this is really now just an infinite sum of the Itô integrals that we studied yesterday. So that's why I really like this setting through these functions gk's, because it really boils down to what we have seen yesterday. And okay, in addition, one has to remember that there is the infinite sum. We have to make sure that it converges, but we just need a linear growth assumption for these guys. Or we need something somehow for these functions gk's so that the sum is converging. Yeah, but other than that, we don't have to worry about any operators anymore because these are really just one-dimensional integrals. Okay, so that's nice. Now it's also not so difficult to understand what happens if I take my stochastic integral and if I apply a test function to it. Yeah, let's say here this could be the duality in L2, L2 over the torus. Maybe you can think about it now while I erase the blackboard. Somehow, what happens here? So we have said, okay, this takes values in H, which is precisely this space here. And if I take a function in the same space, I can take the inner product. Yeah. I want to discuss these points now because for the Navier Stokes equations, we will need test functions. So actually, we will need to even multiply by smooth test functions. So you can also think of phi being smooth. And yeah, I would like to have a formula and have everything clear now. Okay. So you can think about it, what this is now, actually. I think we don't need this anymore. So what I want to show you is that actually I can use this expansion that we have found. Exactly, I can exchange the integrals with the sum. So here I will have the sum over k integral from 0 to little t. And I can really put the inner product inside. So this is now in L2 over the torus dwk. Yeah, so this is also nice that one can somehow interchange all these things. And now, again, now this is really, so these take values in real numbers. So this is really now, again, back to our original situation, one-dimensional situation. Yeah. Okay, so this is for the introduction of the stochastic integral. Are there any questions to this? It does not seem to be the case. So what I would like to discuss now is the concepts of solutions to stochastic differential equations. Yeah, and I will start. It's again something we will need later for the Navier Stokes, but I want to start with a simpler setting, just a stochastic differential equation in a finite dimension. But of course, the same concepts of solution apply to the infinite dimensional setting as well. Okay, so let us think about such a stochastic differential equation. Yeah. Maybe. What that means in principle, somehow one could, yeah, this is really a formal writing. So I could divide by dt, and so you have it somehow more in the ODE way. So it's like you want to consider this ODE where B is some coefficient, but you want to also include the stochastic noise. Yeah, so that would be then. Something like this, but again there is the question that the time derivative of the Brownian motion does not make sense. And so really we usually write SPDs and SDEs in this form, and what that means is this guy is really the stochastic Itô integral, as we understood that already. Yeah, and so the correct way actually how to understand this whole picture is if I also include some initial condition x0. So we understand this equation in the integral way. That means I integrate basically from 0 to t. So x at time t is equal to the initial condition. Then the integral of the drift plus a stochastic integral. So this is a way how these expressions are always understood. Yeah. Okay, and for simplicity, we can really think just about a one-dimensional situation. W is a one-dimensional Brownian motion. X will be also real valued, but you already know, you will see immediately how to reformulate things if we were in finite dimension but higher than one, or even infinite dimension. Yeah, because you already know how the stochastic integral works. Okay. And so there are actually two concepts of solution to SDEs or SPDEs in general. So what could that be? Well, you see the coefficients B and sigma, they are given to us. So they are really part of the data of the problem. The question is whether or not the Brownian motion is given to us. Now, because you remember, I mean, Brownian motion sits on some probability space. As a consequence, also the solution X sits on the same probability space. It has to. The initial condition can be random in general, so it also sits on some probability space. And so the question is whether these probabilistic elements, the probability space and the Brownian motion, whether they are given to us in advance. So somebody gives you a probability space, gives you a Brownian motion, and tells you, well, solve the equation here. Or another situation could be that they give you the freedom to choose whatever Brownian motion you want. Yeah? As a consequence, you would also choose the probability space. And we will see that in some situations, we cannot solve equations on a given probability space. We don't know how to. This will be actually the case for the stochastic Navier-Stokes system. Yeah, so in a sense, what happens there is that the probabilistic elements, the probability space and the Brownian motion, they become part of the solution. So not only am I looking for the process X, but also for W and also for the corresponding probability space. Yeah, so this is how we distinguish the two main notions of solution. So the first one is where everything is given. This is called probabilistically strong solution. So that means somebody gives you a Brownian motion and gives you a probability space. Probabilistically strong, I call them pathwise. The second notion where the Brownian motion, let me write it here, Brownian motion given. The second notion where the Brownian motion is part of the solution, so this is called probabilistically weak. I call them martingale, where W becomes part of the solution. So you may, the reason why I use these different names is because I like to work on SPDEs. And in the PDE setting, you have already weak and strong solutions. So I don't want to have to say like 1,000 times that it's probabilistically weak, analytically weak, or probabilistically strong, analytically weak, whatever. So I use these different names, not only me actually, pathwise and martingale. Okay. What you could also think about is why is this one weak and this one strong? I mean, in which sense is this one really stronger? Yeah, so it's really because the Brownian motion is given to you. So if a strong solution exists, that means for every given Brownian motion you can find a solution to your equation, then also martingale solution exists because that means there is a Brownian motion. Okay, and so I would like to now formulate the definitions, really in detail. And the first definition is that of a pathwise solution. So let W be a real valued Brownian motion on omega f, and I include the filtration here. Yeah, so that means there is a probability space and there is a filtration given to me, and I have a Brownian motion with respect to this filtration. So this is given, and I said that also the initial condition can be random. Okay, so if the initial condition is random, we should also understand it should be somehow measurable with respect to some sigma algebra. Yeah, and we remember the solution cannot look into the future, because then we would have a problem with the stochastic integral here. So, I mean, we should postulate that also the initial condition doesn't look into the future, right? So we want to postulate the initial condition at time zero. So we want that it is F not measurable. Yeah, so it does not see the future of the Brownian motion. Random variable. Okay, so this is given to me now. And now, let's say R valued process X is a pathwise solution with the initial condition X naught, if, and now I will need a number of assumptions. Okay, so first of all, we should not forget the progressive measurability, right? Because I need it for the stochastic integral. And you remember the little lemma that I mentioned yesterday, how to check actually progressive measurability in practice. That was the process shall be adapted, and if it has continuous trajectories, we're happy. Yeah, so this is what I will postulate here. X is FT adapted. And has continuous trajectories. Yeah, I said actually right continuous is enough, but we can prove even more here. Let me call this 1. Now the second condition is the initial value. So at time 0, I want that the process is equal to x0, almost surely. Okay. Then I want to say that the equation is satisfied, which means precisely this. So let me put here plus. But I also have to make sure that every integral here is well defined. Yeah. So this should be a well defined Lebesgue integral, and here should be a well defined Itô integral. So as a third condition, I postulate that P or let me postulate even a little bit more. So I want that the expectation of the integral from 0 to capital T, I will be solving this equation on 0 capital T. Now the Lebesgue integral shall be well defined, which means B of X shall be in L1, plus, now for the stochastic term, sigma X of S, here we need the square. Yeah, so you see, if I forget the drift, this is precisely my condition so that the stochastic integral is well defined. And okay, for the drift, I just need it to be Lebesgue integrable with respect to time. In principle, I don't need this expectation here, but since we will be able to prove it, let me just keep it that way. So actually it's stronger than what I really need, but we will have that, so we don't care. Okay. Yeah, and so under these conditions, my formula plus over there should also be satisfied. So that means this and plus holds true, P almost surely for all T in the interval 0, capital T. I cannot hear. Well, so at the moment, I'm just defining a notion of a solution. The next question is, what assumptions do I need on my coefficients B and sigma so that the solution exists and so that it is maybe unique? Yeah, and this is where these assumptions would come into play. So at the moment, I just postulate basically that the integrals make sense. Yeah, thank you, that's a very good point. Yeah, so, exactly. That is also a very good point. So when I write it this way, be almost sure for, that means there is only one null set. Yeah, if I wrote it in the other order, first for every t almost surely, that would mean that there is a null set for every t. But it does not matter, actually. Yeah, so here I postulate already the stronger one, there is only one null set, but everything will be continuous. Therefore, eventually, even if I wrote really for every t, p almost surely, that means for every t there is a null set, I can then use continuity, yeah, to prove that there is only one null set. Yeah, but that's a very good point. Thank you. Okay, maybe some other questions or remarks? No. Do you mean discontinuity here? Well, it can be derived from the formulation. I mean, in a sense, it's somehow, I need progressive measurability to have the stochastic integral well defined. And these two imply progressive measurability. Yeah, but I agree with you, there are also, I mean, other conditions that imply progressive measurability. So I could put here progressively measurable, then I don't have to worry about continuous. And actually, probably what would be then proved is there exists a version which is continuous. Yes, but somehow, yeah, that's also fine. Yes, that's also a very good point. Maybe some others? We still have some time. So what you can do now is to think about how I should modify this definition so that I write down the definition of a martingale solution. Yeah, so I should somehow modify these things. Also, one point that I haven't discussed so far, what you can now think about is, if we speak about martingale solutions, so that means we don't need the we don't have the probability space at the beginning. It is not given to us in advance. It is a part of the solution. So in which sense can we actually postulate an initial condition? Right? Because if the initial condition is random, it needs a probability space. And somehow it's like when I start solving my equation, when I start the proof, I don't know on which probability space I end up. So we need to figure out somehow a different way how to postulate the initial condition. In other words, we need a replacement for this. So this is also what you can think about now. Okay, so definition number two. Any suggestions for the initial condition? Maybe we think about it a little more. Oh no, I need it now, so somebody has to tell me.
Law.
Exactly. Yeah, so I cannot know the initial condition in advance as a random variable, because I don't have the probability space. And so the only information that I could use is the law of such a random variable. Let's say if X naught was now a mapping from omega, where we have the probability measure, so some probability space to, let's say, R with the Borel sigma field. Yeah, we already spoke about the push-forward measure, so the distribution of this random variable. It is, okay, now it's not very consistent. Here I have the probability measure. There is also the sigma algebra. Yeah, so I can define a push-forward measure on this new space. I will use this notation p x naught to minus 1. So this is now a probability measure on this space, and this is the probability distribution of my random variable x naught. Yeah, and this is really the only information that I can postulate now on my initial value. Okay, so in other words, somebody gives me a probability measure on R, and I call it capital lambda. So it is a Borel measure on R. Okay, and so now I said, well, the solution consists not only of my process X, but also of the probability space and also of the Brownian motion. Yeah, so I actually a solution, even though it looks surprising, it is a triple. So there is a stochastic basis. Now, probability space with a filtration is usually called a stochastic basis. So this is one element. Now there is the process itself, and there is a Brownian motion. Yeah? So that's why I say it's a triple. So this is now called a martingale solution. Solution with the initial law lambda. Okay, and again, I need some conditions. Okay, some of them will be similar as here. So first of all, I should say what are all these elements of my solution. So there is a stochastic basis, omega f ft is a stochastic basis. So that means a probability space with a filtration. Now w is a real valued Brownian motion on this stochastic basis. Okay, so that's good. And now many conditions must be the same as here, right? So the first one, x is FT adapted and has continuous trajectories. I keep it exactly the same way. For the initial condition, we said, well, we cannot write it down this way, but we want to say that x at time 0 has the law capital lambda. In other words, I can use again my notation of the push-forward measure. So this is the push-forward measure generated by x at time 0, and this should be equal to my given measure capital lambda. Oh, sorry, this is not I, this is... Let me put the I here. So I don't write it down again. It's the I from over there. So then we have this. And then this line remains the same. So let me also put it here. 1, 2, 3. And that's it. Yeah, so this is now the second definition. and you see really clearly the difference. So first of all, the initial condition has to be postulated differently. Second of all, these probabilistic elements are part of the solution. Okay, so we don't have much time anymore. Yeah, maybe I can recall the basic results, because then we would also see what assumptions do we actually need on the coefficients so that maybe a pathwise solution exists. And what is the situation when only martingale solution exists? Yeah, so one theorem is the following. This is the setting that you mentioned. If I postulate Lipschitz continuity, global Lipschitz continuity, then I have a unique pathwise solution. So this is really the usual theorem that you know from the ODE setting. Lipschitz continuous coefficients, you close your eyes and you have existence of a unique solution. And that's the same here for SPDEs. So let B sigma be global Lipschitz. Let the stochastic basis FTP and a Brownian motion be given. So Lipschitz coefficients are really nice, and I can construct unique pathwise solutions. Okay, and I also, okay, let me take the initial condition, be F naught measurable. And the claim is then there exists a unique pathwise solution. Oops. Yeah, so this is really the good setting that we know from the ODE situation. Global Lipschitz coefficients, we have existence, we have uniqueness, and therefore also pathwise solutions exist. Okay, you may think about a proof. It's very similar to what you would do in the deterministic situation. Yeah, so Picard iterations, and you prove that everything converges. So the proof is not, it is not so elementary, because I still didn't tell you how we can estimate the stochastic integral. This is what you would need there to really prove that. I would like to now mention a setting when we don't know whether pathwise solutions exist, and we can only prove existence of a martingale solution. So this is the next theorem, and here the assumptions on the coefficients B and sigma are different. They are weaker. In other words, so what I put there is B sigma, they are continuous with linear growth. Yeah, and again, I am given a probability measure. On R, and the claim is there exists a martingale solution. Okay, so you see in this setting, I don't have the Lipschitz continuity assumption. As a consequence, I also don't have uniqueness. Yeah, and what I okay. So as a consequence, I don't have uniqueness, and I can only construct martingale solutions. Now let me say a few words to the proof, because it will be very similar to what we will do for the Navier Stokes system. Yeah, so how does this go? Well, we already have the theorem for global Lipschitz coefficients. And the idea here is to approximate my coefficients by some nicer ones. And I would actually like to use that theorem. So what I do in the first step, I approximate B and sigma by, let's say, Bn sigma n Lipschitz. So this can be certainly done by some modification and cutoff. That's not a problem. And now the advantage is that for these coefficients, I can apply my first theorem. That means for every given probability space, I have a solution, let's call it xn. So fix n, apply the previous result. So this gives me a solution xn. And now the idea is, of course, to pass to the limit. So these coefficients approximate my original one, so there would be convergence in a suitable sense. What I need to prove is that my solutions xn converge also to some limit. And I also have to say why the limit solves my equation. And so I have to identify the limit as a solution. Okay, and so to prove the convergence of these approximations, I need some compactness. Yeah, this is what I would like to prove. This is also what you would do in the deterministic setting. You would prove some uniform bounds and they would give you compactness. Yeah, but if you think about the stochastic situation, it is much more delicate because we have this additional randomness variable. There is this omega. Yeah, and so I can prove some compactness with respect to time by proving maybe some Hilbert continuity uniformly. But I will never get any compactness in omega because you remember omega is just a set. There is no topology on it even. Yeah, so I really cannot expect any compactness in omega by means of any estimates. So somehow the probabilistic compactness that we could prove is the so-called tightness. In other words, this is a compactness of the push-forward measures generated by these solutions. And this way, I would get a compactness at least of these probability laws. But still, I would like to somehow have actual convergence. And for that, I apply the so-called Skorohod. Representation theorem. And this is a very useful theorem because it allows us to really prove the compactness in omega. But the price to pay is we have to change the probability space. So the Skorohod representation theorem tells me that there exists a new probability space. And there exist new random variables x tilde n, x tilde on this new space. So that the following two conditions hold. So first of all, these should be somehow linked to my approximations xn. Yeah, but they live on different probability spaces, therefore what I can only compare again is the law. So the push-forward measure on the old space xn to minus 1, which is the law of xn, is the same as the law of the x tilde n. Okay, now this looks complicated, but what it just means, these two random variables have the same law. So this is what links these new guys to the original approximations. And moreover, I gain convergence. So x tilde n converges almost surely to x tilde. Can everybody see this here? Okay, so what I wrote there, the second thing, sorry, is x tilde n converges almost surely to x tilde. Yeah, so even though on the original probability space I am not able to prove convergence almost surely because I don't have the compactness, through this Skorohod representation theorem, when I change the probability space, I am able to get there. Yeah. And now with this and with the convergence of the coefficients, there is a method how to pass to the limit and how to really identify the limit as the solution. So x tilde will be a solution. So I should identify x tilde, I should prove that it really satisfies the equation. Yeah, the question is, of course, what is the Brownian motion? Because you see, we have to change the probability space here, we have to find a new Brownian motion on that space. And this is what I will then discuss, maybe not in detail here, but on the example of the Navier Stokes system. Yeah, and with this, I would like to stop. Maybe you have some questions first. Okay, if there are no immediate questions, you can also contact me later. Thank you very much.